In this video, we're going to be taking a look at the Revit content for a selection of products from the Intrim railing range. So this is going to include the IHR10 handrail, the BR04 bump rail, and the ConnectaRail system. So coming back to the download portal, we do have a separate family file available per product, and that's available in various different file versions as well. So these have been created as line-based families, and as such, they're very similar in the way that they're controlled and drawn within a project. However, we will come across some parameters that are product-specific, particularly for the more complex connector rail system, which required a higher level of control and detail. Coming now into our Revit project, we can see that I've already laid out a series of walls as well as a door in our 3D view, ready for placement of these railings. So once loaded into our project, the component families can be found in our project browser under the Railings category, and we have the BR04, the connector rail, and the IHR10 as separate family files with various types applicable to the product. So as mentioned, these railings draw in much the same way as each other, so I'll quickly demonstrate how we can draw these into our project using the IHR10 before moving on to some of the more product-specific parameters. Placing the standard type for the IHR10 handrail family into our active Revit view will automatically put us in the place component mode. So here we have some options which define the way in which the railing instance will be drawn within our project. The first thing to consider is whether or not this is to be placed on a work plane or placed on a face. So typically place on face will be used when we have a ramp in our project and we're looking to follow the gradient of the ramp and replicate that in our railing. I will use place on work plane for this example, but the way which we draw is very much the same. So we then have the option of picking lines or draw line. So draw line would work by selecting your start point and end point to generate the railing, whereas we do have the option to pick line, and in that example you just follow the walls along and it automatically locks and hosts itself to the face of the wall. Before I do any of that though, I want to open the properties dialog here, and we just need to touch on a few instance parameters that are working in the background of these families. So while we're drawing, it's important to keep an eye on your end 1 and end 2 conditions. And what these do is, if I update, for example, the end 2 condition to be an internal corner, you can see that my N2 clearance has gone from 50mm to 150mm. So you want to be setting your end conditions, which then applies the necessary clearance zones and in turn feeds your length ANZRS parameter, which is a calculated parameter which indicates the total length of the timber component of your handrail. So not the length that you draw it at, but the length that the timber handrail is after the cutbacks have been applied. So what we mean by that is, if I quickly place this, so we're going from a wall end to an internal corner, so that one's okay. This wall here, we're looking to go from an external corner to a wall end. So simply by tweaking my end conditions here to suit, you can quite quickly apply these railings and with the manufacturer specified clearances applied. So if I was to use the pick line for this example, we are going to see that it actually cuts right across my door. So I'm going to undo that and come to a plan view here. And rather than using my pick line, I'm going to draw the line in. Again, with my instance parameters open here, we are going in this length here, looking for an internal corner to a window or door. And as we're drawing, we're making sure that we lock these in. So if the thickness or the position of any of these walls change, our railing will also follow. And our last length, we're going from a window or door to a external corner. So we do have a few other options here, one being no clearance. I'll just open this out a bit. So when no clearance is applied to either or both ends, you can see that the timber component of the handrail actually extends to exactly where we draw to and from. So we don't really recommend using that unless it's absolutely vital, because these clearance zones have been stipulated by the manufacturer. So as such, they will likely need to be implemented during construction, and it's best to have them applied from the design phase. The other option that we have, if I create another length out here in space, once we exceed the maximum allowable length of our railing, which I believe is 3.6 meters, you can see that we actually have an automatic warning message become generated. And this is saying that we've exceeded the 3.6 meter length, maximum length, and we would need to set a rail break to one or both of the ends of this particular railing. So that is in itself an end condition. And to make this all a bit more clear, what we can do is apply the visibility show end clearances parameter. And that actually represents those clearance zones in plan and 3D view to give a bit of a better idea of what's happening. So when we have a length that we're looking to achieve that's longer than that allowable 3.6 meters, we're going to need to break it up into several lengths. And when they butt up against each other, you want to make sure that your rail break is up against the next rail break. And this is then going to ensure that you can achieve an overall length, but with the necessary 50 millimeter combined offset from your rail ends. So as already mentioned, any of these railing families that we've created can be hosted to a slope surface, such as a ramp in Revit. Quickly place a ramp in my project. And what I might do is turn off the end clearances. So we're going to want to make sure that for drawing on slope surfaces, we have place on face selected. And then we are wanting to select that top face of our ramp. And you can be a bit more careful about where you draw this. I'm being a bit rough, but needless to say, the result is a railing that follows the gradient of the face that we're hosting it to, and it will follow that ramp. Wherever I move the ramp, the railing will go. And also, if I change the pitch of that ramp, so too will the railing update to facilitate that. So now that we've got the basics of how to draw with these railing systems, I just want to have a closer look at the other two products, being the BR04 and the ConnectaRail. So if I copy across my walls, and I'll remove the door for this particular example, swap to a realistic view so we can start to see some materials applied. I'm going to have the option for the BR04 bump rail of three separate types, being the top rail, bottom rail, and both rails, being a combination of both. So that is your top rail, bottom rail, and both rails. Again, as we go, we'd be entering our end1 and end2 condition, which would have unique values based on this particular product. I won't bother because it's the same process as what we've just done for the IHR10. However, I just wanted to illustrate that we had three separate types defining the possible combinations that we can achieve with this BR04 product. Again, you can see that we've exceeded the maximum rail length, being 3 meters in the case of the BR04. So that is when, again, we would use our rail break. To create continual lengths. And you'd want that one to be rail break going to an external corner for lengths over 3 meters in the case of your BR04. Just lastly, I want to take a look at the ConnectaRail family. So I'm going to start in my 2D plan view here by drawing a few walls at 45 and 90 degree bends. Coming now into my properties dialog box, we can see that we have a 40 and a 50 millimeter type, and that's referring to the diameter of the timber component, so the timber dowel within the railing. So again, we have these end 1 and end 2 conditions. However, we don't have the range that we did with the bump rail and the handrail. It's a matter of internal, external, or normal. So typically, you would use normal for the wall returns. And the reason that I've got these walls at 45 and 90 degrees exclusively at this stage is because the connector rail comes with stainless steel bend elements, which you can see fix onto the 45 and 90 degree bends. So we're seeing this because I haven't actually set my end conditions. But coming back to my first length here, so we want to actually go to an internal corner at 45. We need this second length to start on an internal corner at 45 and also finish at an internal corner of 45. Again, internal corner of 45 to start, and that will be going to an external 90 degree corner like thus. So you can see as I select any length that we're actually getting a doubling up of those bend brackets, and because they're shared components that actually then carry through to our schedule, what we need to ensure is that we're turning off one or the other. So you'll notice if I turn off show end 1 and show end 2 of this first length, we're actually left with neither. So you want to make sure one is selected, but where we have this weird overlaying effect occurring, it just means that we actually need to manually override whether they're showing up in our project. So we can now look at how the family deals with a angle that is not 45 or 90 degrees. So if I come to an angle like this, for example, and we're actually going to consider that angle as 31. So again, I'll just come back and set up my end conditions, but I will say for... And to be honest, when we're dealing with these, it doesn't really matter if end 1 or end 2 are turned on, because we're not actually going to get a bracket in the corner anyhow. So you probably want your end 2 on this one, and I will change that to be normal at 90 to get my wall return. So we want this internal corner for my first length to be set to 31 degrees, and you can see there that it actually miters my edge. And again, when we say internal corner of 31 for my second length, they will actually butt up against each other like this. And coming to a 3D view, we start to get a better idea of what's happening here versus where we actually have the bend brackets fixed. So these as well can be swapped out for the 40 millimeter. You can see that the dowel updates, and so too does the connecting elements and the brackets. The brackets, we have options here in terms of bracket type. So currently by default we have the HBO3S. With our selector, we can choose between the HBO3S and the HBO2CS. And that will change the graphics slightly because they actually sit beneath the dowel, like that. As well as a bit of choice in terms of the materials applied. So we do have satin black currently applied for the brackets, and I can change this to be a basic flat stainless steel, natural steel. See that that's updated the bracket appearance. So as mentioned, these brackets and components that are joining the dowel are also carrying through to the railing schedule, Once in our railing schedule, you can see that we have a separate entry per length of railing that we've been drawing over the course of this video. We also have the addition of these corner nested components. These are the corner bends that we will use for the 45 and 90 degree bends in our connector rail. We have some additional parameters here that we've built in, being bracket type and bracket count, as well as some manufacturer specific parameters such as your URLs and product descriptions. Thank you so much for taking the time to watch this overview of the Revit content for the Intrim railing products. As you can see, there's nothing overly complex involved in drawing with these line-based families, yet when compared to the traditional Revit railing system tool, we're able to achieve a much more accurate and realistic final result.